Micaiah, and welcome back to your favorite episode. Let's talk. So with that being said, So guys, today I have a very interesting video for you, and I am really excited because today we have a special guest. Our special guest today is a mighty woman of God. Okay, I met this wonderful woman, this wonderful lady, this lady of grace. I met her a couple years ago at a conference that we both attend annually. Our father's churches are a part of it. The gathering, I met her, it had to be a couple years ago, probably like 3 years ago. And I love this lady, okay? I love this girl. I love her so. I'm so excited for what's about to take place in this video. So with all that being said, let me stop talking. Let's get her in. Let's introduce her and all that stuff like that. So with that being said, let's get in to the video. So guys, I am back and I am excited. I'm excited with this special guest. Can someone give me a drum roll, please? You know, our special guest is Miss Victoria, the one and only Victoria Hardy. Y'all, all the way from Alabama. See, y'all don't understand how excited I am. So, like I told y'all in the intro, I've known Victoria for like how?
We know each other from global.
Yes.
First year, so whenever you started, that's probably
well. Actually, I saw you 2 years after I started going to global.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, I did not know that.
Yes.
Okay.
And so it's probably like maybe 3 years now.
Yeah,
maybe
3 years.
Three, baby. So about that time, and y'all, when I tell y'all, Victoria is a force to be wrecked. Like, she don't play. She don't play. She look all cute and all subtle, but this girl, y'all. Okay, so Victoria, hi. How are you?
Great. I was just talking to some other people from Global. I was like, we're supposed to be packing up our bags right
yes.
now.
Yes.
Our way to what is it? Ohio, I think Cincinnati.
Yes, Ohio, Cincinnati, Ohio.
We were supposed to be packed our way, but you know, God had otherwise, and that's all right with me. But yeah, I'm really happy right now. I'm excited. I've been spending a lot of time with my family, mm-hmm. and friends, and my word a lot more. I mean,
come on.
I'm so yeah, in spite of everything that's going in the world, I'm still.
No, you're right. You're right. I do miss you guys, but you know what? Next year we'll be back and stronger than ever. And it is so. And like the young people saying, that's on period, child. Lord have mercy.
Right.
Okay, so before we even jump into some questions, because y'all, I got some questions for Victoria, because Victoria is a spokesperson. Okay. I want you to tell us about yourself. You know, where you're from. Are you in college? If you're in college, what you're doing? You know, give us some stuff.
Okay. I'm Victoria. As you guys know, I'm from the historic, the heart of the civil rights movement, Montgomery, Alabama. And so, yes, I live my hometown very strong. I am a rising sophomore at Fair Dealer University in New Orleans, and I do a lot on campus. I'm on SGA, NAACP, journalism type stuff. I'm in a lot of ministry stuff. Mm-hmm. I just do everything, and I just love doing stuff like this, talking to people. Communication is my major, mass communication. So this is my cup of tea. So I'm really excited. So. Yeah, that's a little bit about me. I'm a preacher's kid. My dad is Bishop Frederick Hardy. And my pastor in New Orleans, Bishop Blake.
Mm-hmm.
I love him so much. Shout out from home. But yeah, that's just a little bit about me. church all my life, ministry all my life. I've gone, had my walk with Christ and everything. And I'm just young, black, beautiful, and saved, okay?
Dang! I'ma steal that. I am young, black, beautiful, and saved. And it is so. So number one, before I even get to questions, because now she done got me interested, because I did not know her major was math communications, because that's my major.
Come on!
I did not know that. I know.
Listen.
Now I knew because, you know, before this, I had to go look up on some stuff and go through Facebook. Yes, I did. And I saw some pictures and stuff, but I was like, okay, baby, maybe. So, yes, yeah, mass communications.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. How did you get into that? We're going to get to the questions, I promise y'all. But how did you get into that?
Ever since I was young, I always had a passion about informing people, bringing up conversations, communicating. I think communication is a big thing. Mm-hmm. To have, and it's necessary, especially now. We all need to communicate with each other better.
True.
And so, you know, my parents taught me, don't complain about something you're not going to fix, okay? So I explained about how people don't have great communication skills, so guess what I did? I majored in mass communication. And I'm just really passionate about my science. I'm passionate about, you know, the things that happen to our people, the things that go on in this country and even around the world.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I'm gonna be an international broadcast journalist, hopefully, eventually.
Okay.
So yeah, I love talking to people. I love writing. I love typing. I love panels. I love all of it. Anything with communication.
I love it all. Okay, y'all, I'm excited. Cause now when I go to, I'm gonna be like, so Victoria, you had this class yet? I'm gonna need, I need some help. Oh yes, as you heard, Victoria is a woman of many talents. Oh, if you didn't know, I think me and Victoria are the same age. I think you're 19, right?
Yes, 19, yes.
Okay, so we're the same age. So glory be to God. Yes. Hallelujah. So you heard she's in college. You know, she's doing mass communications. You know, she reps her city. She reps where she's from. She reps it hard. She reps her school hard. She's very involved in her community, very involved in school. And she's a PK, which we're going to jump into later on. You gotta jump into later on because, us PKs, yes, we need some help out here, okay? We need help. And so, just to start everything on, you know, just to start it light before we get into some deep questions, okay? I want you to tell us, you know, you've grown up in church, so what is your funniest memory? Victoria, like, girl, that's hard. It's always funny. What you mean? In church.
Probably, it may have been like 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And I just finished leading a song. And I mean, we was shocked. We was dope. The church is going crazy. And I, my heel, I was on stage. And my heel got stuck in a crack. Like, in the floor, like the stage had these little cracks in it. We could get that fixed. But it happened.
Should have pulled that move when they fall, they just act like they fell out. Just
I was just so in shock. I was like, did I just fall in front of everybody?
She said, not on the live, God. Not on the live.
Yes.
Oh, Lord. That's funny. You okay, though? It's fine. Listen.
I know.
Listen. From a worship leader to a worship leader, I have had my blouse fell down, all types of stuff.
Right, all types of stuff.
it's be embarrassing, okay? It's just like, whoo, hallelujah. So I feel you on that. Okay, next question. Are you ready? Are y'all ready? Okay. So this question is, what is the common misconception that you deal with, not only as a young person, but being a pastor's daughter?
That I'm wild. And that, you know, everyone has that conception that preacher's kids, preacher's daughters, you know, they be the worst ones. And I'm not like that. I never had that. Now, let me tell you, okay? Let me tell you. Now, I done made some mistakes. But I'm not like how everybody perceives preacher kids. Like mm-hmm. these terrible people who just do all kinds of stuff, who just go out and leave the church and leave their families and stuff like that. My parents never really forced my relationship with God. You know, they kind of let me and my brother build mm-hmm. our own relationship. You know, they didn't want it to be like, oh, you gotta do this, you gotta do that, you gotta do that. Whatever ministry we wanted to participate in, we participated in it. Whatever, when we wanted to, when we found our heavenly language, that's when we found our heavenly language. Mm-hmm. It wasn't forced, you know? And so I never dealt with the stereotypes or anything like that. My walk with Christ was on my own. I made mistakes, yes, but I was never all wild and stuff like that. And I mean, I think that's probably the biggest stereotype, being wild. I just don't think all preachers' kids are crazy.
Come on. No, I'm so glad you said that, because listen, and my parents happened to pastor in the Bahamas, okay? Whole different territory. And that is one of the biggest misconceptions, that all preachers' kids are wild. And especially, I love all the brothers out there, but when you're a female.
Yeah, when you're a female, it's different.
When you're a female, they think you trifling. You know, and that's not true.
It's not true.
It's not
true.
They
try to find something to defend that. Like, they try to find something only to defend that narrative that they created on their own.
Girl, listen.
That was probably the biggest thing, is people think that, or people think that I'm supposed to be perfect.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, you think that I'm wild, or you see, you think I'm wild, or you think that I'm perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And that actually messed up a lot, because when people had this mindset and this idea that I was perfect and I did everything right and all this other kind of stuff, and when I did something wrong and it was shown publicly, it flipped. It turned the tail, because they already held me to a high standard.
Yeah.
And so I think that's another misconception, is people looking at you as perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just, it's unrealistic. I mean, I'm a kid, I'm a teenager, I'm just like everybody else. I make mistakes, you know. Mm-hmm. I'm not perfect. I love God to death. Like, for real, that's not, you know,
I'm so
for real. But I have made mistakes, and so, you know, people always have that conception of preacher's kids.
No, I feel you on that. I feel you. Did you watch my video? Did you watch the preacher's kids video?
Oh, I think I did watch some of it.
Listen, I get you. I have had people tell me, oh, you know, yeah, Micaiah pregnant, all type of stuff. Listen, okay, I feel you. I feel you.
I have a lot of stories. Okay, it's a lot of them, but you know.
One day we gotta come back and just be a PK right. thing. One day we gotta come back. You know, we gotta move on to the next question. But I just want y'all to know. If you were PK, if you were LK, you know, leaders' kids, deacons' kids, you know the vibe.
Right. Yes.
You know.
Yes. You know. Yes.
All right. So let's dive into the next question. Okay. Yes. So next question is, what struggle did you face growing up in your faith walk, and how did you overcome that? Not the
I have a lot of struggles. I think the first thing would probably, I would say, discipline. I struggled a lot growing up as with being able to, trying to balance life, you know, and I wasn't disciplined enough to be like, okay, I know everybody else is doing this. You can't do that. Not just because you're a preacher's kid, because you're a Christian.
Yeah.
And I think that's a big thing, is a lot of preacher kids do things because they're preacher kids, when, you know, me on the other hand, I did stuff due to me being a Christian.
Mm-hmm.
But it was, I feel like I had a lot of lack of discipline. I wanted to experience, but at the same time, I wanted to be in alignment.
Yes.
And I just, that was one of the struggles for me. And I think also another struggle is courage. I had, when I first started building my relationship with God personally, you know, I've been going to church all my life, but when I really first started building my relationship with God, I wasn't so vocal about it. Like how I saw everybody else being, like, I wasn't the one to run in the church or jump and shout. I wasn't that at first. Now,
y'all, Victoria be getting on them little Facebook lives.
I will, okay? I don't care. My adrenaline. What is it called?
Your adrenaline. Your adrenaline.
Yes. It be so high when I be in church. Like, I be feeling expressive, and I just be ready. But at first, I had to work my way up there. I was not like that. And I think that was one of the courage and pride and being a Christian, of pride in your God, you know, and not being afraid of what people stuff like that. So that was probably my biggest struggles. Another one would probably be trying to imitate. That was a struggle of mine growing up at first. I tried to imitate. And it's not, I've heard people say this, I heard all those prophets and stuff say, it's okay if you copy the right cat. Just don't copy wrong. And I was, and you know, but I because I was trying to learn, I found myself imitating. And I had to get, it wasn't sincere. It wasn't unique. Like, even my prayer life, like when I first started really getting into my prayer life, it wasn't really coming from me. It wasn't really coming from my heart. It was from what I heard. You know? So I really had to look deep inside and be authentic with God. And so that was probably three of my struggles. Those was just, it's probably a whole bunch more, but I'm gonna let you go on to the next question.
Victoria, I'm gonna need to bring you back and do a whole series on with you. Because Victoria, listen, now I'm mad that me and Victoria don't talk often as we should. After this, I'm gonna need you to get my number, because we correspond over Facebook. But Vicky,
listen, you're
like, excuse me, I get hyper and I tend to yell. But no, that's some awesome stuff, especially the last one with imitating, because we is not just young folks, we is preachers' kids, we just people who grew up in church. You know, it's easy to look at what you see and listen, my mama is a prophetess praying intercessor.
Right.
You know, that's what she does. That's who she is.
Yeah.
And so in the beginning of our prayer life, she really had to be like, hey, don't pray like me.
Don't pray like me.
Pray like you. You are having your own conversation with God. This is you and God. This isn't me, you and God. No, this is you and God. And so, no, that is something we as people have to learn, not to imitate. And because, oh, you see people do this, then this is how you do. And even you lead worship. I lead worship. You know, and my father was a worship leader before he was a pastor. And so it's like, I can't lead worship how my dad lead worship, because that's how I saw him do it.
Exactly.
Girl, ooh.
Listen. And identity. Gotta find your own identity.
Yes.
The relationship, I mean, it's so easy because we were raised in it. Mm-hmm. And if you raise, like my dad always says, if you take a Chinese baby and you you raise him in an American home, he's going to speak English. Yeah. Even though he's Chinese, he's going to speak English. And so because we were trained, you know, we were raised in church, it's natural for us to, and we don't even do it on purpose, but it's natural for us to imitate.
Yeah.
Instead of mixing and finding our own identity, so.
Girl, ooh, shatabo. You really want me to speak in tongues on here today. That's what you want me to do. Actually, I never realized, but your answer is an awesome segue into this next question. So this next question is, how did you handle being set apart? Not that face, Jesus.
I'm not going to lie, and I keep going back to growing up because it was...
It's okay.
That's really when my PK issues were happening.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm gonna say this. In youth church a lot, I was set apart. I was set apart, not, of course I was set apart by God, of course, but by the youth ministers or just in general, any church that I went to, not just at my church, any church that I went to, because they knew who my father was.
Yes. What is the reason?
And my parents had to discipline me a lot because I was going through how to handle being set apart.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't, when I was younger, I don't think that I handled it well. But now I am handling it better because I know now it's not just I'm set apart, but I'm set apart by God. Like,
yeah.
God chose my mom and dad for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
And because I know it's him who did it now, when I was little, I just felt like it was just the older people picking on me. But now I know it was God actually setting me apart. I can handle it better. Mm-hmm. I can handle the side comments, the slick, the secretive group chats that people be. Come on. Let's talk about them.
Come on.
It'd be the church people talk about folks and group chats. But I'm able to handle it because I'm set apart.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I know my worth. I know that God has put me in this family for a reason. I know what purpose I have in this world. I know all of that. Mm-hmm. And it's easier now. But when growing up, I'm telling you, I did not handle those struggles well. Look, you think I talk a lot now?
She's like, girl.
But, yeah, that's how I
answer that. No, that's awesome because I can totally relate to that. Because now I'm more different when it comes to being a PK because my parents became PKs when I was like, I just became a teenager. So, like, I was like, what, 12, 11? That's when they, you know, started pastoring. But they've always been leaders. And they've always been leaders of leaders. So it wasn't just like, they just on the evangelist team. No, they're over the evangelist team. They're over. Yeah. And so I completely understand where it's like, well, your brother Mike's done. And your sister Tasha's done. And you're just like. So no, listen, right? And so I remember often having those conversations with my parents, like, why do I have to be different? Why do I have to be different? And, you know, it's like you said, understanding that you are not just set apart because of who your parents are. You are set apart because of the call. Like, the call. And God strategically placed you with the people. Because I have to be completely honest. If I didn't have the parents that I had.
Listen. I would be very different.
Mm-hmm.
I would
be a mess. Listen, it's just like your family, who God places you with, is because you are set apart. You were born set apart, you know. And so, it's good on to me. I had to take the phone off the charger and everything. Victoria, you just...
Yes. And my parents did a great job at being still parents and ambitious and first lady. And like my dad, I kid you not, he has been at every doctor's appointment, every single recital that I've had, anything, any sports, any game, anything. He was always there. And I think because he was such a good father, that made him a better bishop. And I think he said, and the thing is, he says all the time, because, you know, he's a pastor, which means he's a spiritual father to people.
Yes.
But what makes him a good spiritual father is being my father. You know, and being able to, because not only is he our father of this house, but he's the prophet in this house. He's the voice of God. House, you know, and so they really, really did a really good job at raising me and my brother in church. I excellent job. And it's been times where, you know, my dad was away a lot because of preaching, because he had to travel and we missed, or Bishop Ellis called him to go somewhere else with him, or all this other kind of stuff. It happened a lot, but I can say that my family did an amazing job at keeping our also a priority.
No, but listen, I believe you. Some my dad does straight talk on Let's Talk. So Let's Talk is my YouTube channel, and he has a segment called Straight Talk, and he had a question asking, how does he balance his personal life with his ministry life? And he answered the question saying, ministry is my life, my family is like my family is my ministry. My church is my, it's all ministry. It's all ministry. And listen, because like you said, not only is he the father in the home, but he's the prophet. He's the voice of God. He's the head. And so, no, I completely agree with you. I completely agree with you. I can attest that from my parents. They did a great job. I can see that your parents did a great job. Listen, and you could tell your father that my father, Pastor Miller, loves him. So you could let me throw him in that shameless plug, because he was like, Hardy daughter. Oh, Hardy. Listen, daddy be like, Hardy, that's my boy. I'm like, okay, so no, like, I can see that your parents did an awesome job. It's a testament. We all see it. Okay, a great segue. Girl, you reading my questions, are you? That's what you're doing. You have my questions, because the way how she is just flowing into these next questions, either she really got the Holy Ghost or she got my question. One of the two. Because, and I say that because the next question was, how has your parents' relationship with God influenced yours?
This image of, well, this picture, I'm so fancy, image, anyways, I have this picture, someone took this picture of me and my mom, and we literally, it's not on purpose, but we have the same stance in worship. I don't know what it is, but we have the same stance in worship, and I mean,
you need to send me that picture so I can put it in the...
Yes, I need to send it to you, because I think it was at my father's live recording. He had a live recording with his home or whatever. And we were just worshiping, and we looked exactly the same. It was beautiful. But my mom, her relationship with God, like, literally was really, like, in me, like, in me. It was just so natural. And I think it's because I really think she prayed for it. I really do. I've never asked her, but I think she prayed for it. And I think she prayed for her to be able to be an image of what God wants in a woman. you know, as far as worship work. And I think that it really played a part in me. I mean, even now, like, I see myself reading my word like she reads it. I see myself praying. Like, she just told me this story about how her and my dad went to Jerusalem. They went on a trip to Jerusalem, and they went to the garden. Gosh, what was the name of that garden that Jesus prayed in?
Gethsemane.
She went to that garden and she said she felt her face.
Oh, Lord.
There was the garden. All white people, sorry, but all the people was like just looking and was like, what's going on? What's going on? But she reverenced that place. She reverenced that place. And even when we talk the same. When we teach the same. And she, and one of the things I love about her is that, and it's unpopular, but she references God. And I'm talking about, you know, a lot of times we stand up and we worship God a lot, but this woman kneels. This woman lays out on the floor. This woman takes her shoes off. And I do the same thing. You know, it's very unpopular now, especially in the denomination that I'm in, that we just always are laid out for God. Like, that doesn't happen all the time. You know, it happens. It's good when it happens, but it's not natural. Like, it's not a reoccurring.
Yeah,
thing.
It's not. Yeah, yeah.
And so, referencing really, really is a part of me because of my mom and my dad. And that's why I got my senior voice from, because my mom was not on the vocal side, but my dad. That's who I got it from, and I think he influenced me, and as a worshiper or as just his relationship with God, I'm not afraid to be vocal about my relationship with God because of my dad. Like, I don't care where we are, we can be at Walmart, my dad will bust out in tongues. I kid you not. Okay? And he scared me when I was little. But now I find myself, I don't know, I be feeling it, I be like, oh. And it comes straight out. And see, and it's just so authentic. I mean, my dad is just, I the way he teaches, the way he preaches, I see it in me as well. Like, I don't know. I think I'm a combination of both. I really do. I think God put my parents' way of relationship with him and my daddy's way of relationship with him, my mama, and put it all together and put it in me. Just like this. And I think that's really what happened. But I mean, I see them pray. I see them, like, just, they don't just preach about it. Okay, this is their lifestyle.
Yes, they live it.
This is my lifestyle. Like, I'm huge enough. Anybody talks about it. And a lot of times,
you got the flow, sis.
Try to worship. Becoming a worshiper and having a relationship with God is so important, because let me tell you something. People pray for miracles and they pray for breakthroughs and stuff like that, but it could be in your worship.
Come on.
You acknowledging and worshiping who God is makes him that person in your life. So if you worship God, you let him know he's a healer, he's gonna be a healer.
Come on.
You know what I'm saying? If you worship God and you know that he's a way maker, a provider, he's going to be that. Sometimes God needs to hear you say that to him. Instead of begging him for something, talk about who he is. Point blank, simple. I mean, I feel, and that's why I'm so into, I'm more about worship than I am about begging God for something. Because it's everything we need is in him. If you just recognize who he is and you start to tap into who he is, that's it right there. Your miracle is in your worship. See, let me.
Victoria!
But I'm serious, because y'all know how many breakthroughs I've had.
Come on!
Just worshiping God. Not saying, God, I need a breakthrough. No. But God, I know you to be the God of David, the God of Joseph. So I know you can do it. That's you. And it can happen right in worship. And I just don't understand why people just love to beg God for something. He's already that. He's already that. You just got to open up your mouth and recognize it. But let me tell you, that's how my parents have influenced my relationship.
Look at the devil. He won't be mad causing the phone to ring. Ain't nobody been calling him. Now the phone won't ring.
But yeah, that's how my parents have influenced my relationship with God. Not just making sure that worship, being a worshiper, was a priority.
Big time. Toria. Now, y'all excuse me because I'm going to start calling her Toria because I feel like in one of the videos I saw her cheerleading because she used to cheerlead. I don't know if she still does. I'm pretty sure I heard Bishop scream in the back, "Go Tori!" So I'm going to call her Tori. I'm pretty sure that's what I heard. Tori! Now I'm going to say it. Girl! Oh my God! Y'all, number one, I'm a tad bit freaked out, and I say that because there's a little bit too much similarities. Just a tad bit. Y'all know my family, and what she's describing sounds like the Miller family, so I'm just a tad bit freaked out. It's okay, just a tad bit. No, because when you talk about prayer and reverence, that is my mother. That is my mother. I pray like my mama. I can't help it. It's not even like that's what's in me. That's what's in me.
Yeah.
I pray like my mama. My daddy like to say, "Oh, she moved like a mama." I move like my mom. Like the way how my mom moves when she warfaring, that's how I move. Just like that. And then it don't help that I look like her either. But you know, that's how I move. And when it comes to worshiping, my dad's the singer. So it's like, I watch him. My dad doesn't know this, so he gonna find this out today. But I studied my father. Especially when it came to his worship, because I remember as a young child listening. I remember him leading worship. I remember watching in awe. And so I used to study that. And so, girl.
Victoria, that worshiper, that's my lifestyle.
Listen.